Fine, you can start.
Okay, fine. Okay. So these are the, these are the headings under which we are going to listen to this presentation. So should posts be used for all endodontically treated teeth? And should they be either custom made or prefabricated? What type of core material should we use over the post? Is coronal coverage required? If yes, what type of coronal coverage? That means, do you need a crown or an inlay or an onlay? And then what type of all ceramic materials are there and where can you use them? And how to achieve predictable restoration? So if you look at, endodontically treated teeth, the biggest question is, are endodontically treated different than regular vital teeth? And if you look at the classic studies, they said that endodontically treated teeth were the same, were different than vital teeth because the dentin was more brittle because of water loss and because there was loss of collagen cross-linking. So because of these, they said that it was different. But in this article, which was written in 1992 in the Journal of Endodontics, they said that the similarity between the biomechanical properties of endodontically treated teeth and their contralateral vital pairs indicates that teeth do not become more brittle following endodontic treatment. We always tell our patients that once we root canal or endodontically treat the teeth, that they become brittle, but that is not the fact. And other factors may be more critical to failure of endodontically treated teeth. We know that the fracture rates of endodontically treated teeth are higher than they are of natural teeth. So what are the reasons for that? So it is now said that the loss of structural integrity due to access preparation, the access cavity preparation, and the missing tooth structure, and not changes in dentin, lead to a higher incidence of fractures in endodontically treated teeth. Also, when you make access cavities, you have increased pulpal deflection. That means the forces are concentrate in these cusps here, and therefore that causes cuspal fracture, and micro leakage, like here. You can see here, because of cuspal deflection, you have fracture of the cusp. And this was the paper that that said it all. When we are either students or practitioners, we always like to listen to our people whom we respect and think that whatever they are saying is the truth. But unfortunately, we need to look at data when we are choosing the way we restore our patients. So just because X or Y or Z says it doesn't mean that it is right. We have to look at the data and then come to a conclusion. So you can see in this study, which was called Biomechanical Considerations in Restoring Endodontically Treated Teeth. This was a very good paper. And this says that the loss of proprioceptive feedback mechanism. We all know that the pulp has got receptors which lead to proprioception. And once the pulp is removed, the proprioception of the tooth is reduced. And this is actually this and the previous reason that I had said about the cuspal deflection. These are the main causes of the higher chance of fracture of the restoration. And not only good endodontic therapy, but also good prosthetic reconstruction of the tooth is required. And so if you see this series of photographs that were given, you can see that this is an unprepared tooth, vital tooth. You can see this is a preparation with a class 1 cavity. This is a preparation with a pulpally involved tooth, but with a small access cavity. Then you have another with a mesial restoration here. So the larger the cavity size becomes, the more you are at risk of fracture of the tooth. So that is why it is extremely important to make the access cavity as small as possible. So I would advise all of you to read this article. It's from the European Journal of Aesthetic Dentistry, 2013. It is freely available on the internet. You do not need to subscribe for it. And it explains all the procedures, how you do a proper restoration, everything it will explain to you. Again, those lines have started coming. So if you see here, this is where the force is applied. This is if it is a class 2 cavity, you can see as the amount of tooth structure is removed, the more tooth structure that is removed, the higher chance there is of cuspal fracture. And if you go in and you make either a crown or an onlay or an endocrown, then you have a higher chance of preserving the teeth. So what about the use of posts? Do we need to put posts for all endodontically treated teeth? Or is it required only in some cases? So the first question is, do posts actually strengthen teeth? And earlier it was thought, when I was a student, when I was doing my BDS in 1980s, I did it from 81 to 87. A lot of you may not have even been born at that time. We were taught that, we need to put posts for all endodontically treated teeth, and actually posts do strengthen teeth. But the current philosophy now is that the primary purpose for a post is to retain a core on a tooth where there is extensive loss of tooth structure, and it does not strengthen the teeth, except in the case of fiber posts where they strengthen the teeth for a short period of time. And the preparation of the post space actually causes fracture. It can actually weaken the tooth structure and it can lead to root fracture. So that is another one of the problems. So if you see this case here, you find there are two teeth side by side, and you find the one on the left has got a post, because you can see that this whole structure here is a filling material, and whereas on the right hand side, only about 1/3 of the tooth is only about that much of the tooth structure is missing. So we will go ahead and place a post on this tooth, but on the left hand side we will not. It is not required to place a. So what about anterior teeth which have been root canaled? So it is now said that if your anterior teeth have minimal tooth structure loss, then you do not require a post, and you can just use a composite bonded restoration to restore it. You don't even need to put a crown on that. So like you have here, you have tooth which has undergone some amount of trauma. A root canal has to be done, and you can find that if you just do a composite restoration on this, you do not need to go ahead and crown every single anterior tooth that is root canal. But if your anterior tooth is going to receive a crown, then a post is often indicated. And the reasons for that is that the anterior teeth must resist lateral and shearing forces, and the pulp chambers are too small to provide adequate retention and resistance form. And therefore, without a post, you will have a higher chance of fracture of the tooth structure. So in a situation like this, you can see adjacent to each other, what I would do is I would go ahead and we had to do a endo for both the teeth, but we placed unfortunately we had to crown both of them. We could have done only a restoration here, but the patient was keen on getting a crown on. So we went back and placed posts in both of them and rehabilitated the patient. What about premolar teeth? Premolar teeth usually have small pulp chambers and are likely to be subjected to greater lateral forces than the molar. So the molars have the least amount of lateral forces, and therefore in premolars also, if an extensive amount of tooth structure is missing, it is better to go ahead and place a post and do a post and gore and a crown. Like we have done in this case, you can see we have placed a post, a fiber post here, and then we have done a post and gore and a crown for the patient. And what about the molar teeth? So in molar teeth, do molar teeth with root canals require posts? You can see in this diagrammatic representation here that almost half, more than half of the tooth structure is missing. But we have still gone ahead without placing a post in that, because the pulp chambers are large enough for us to accommodate the filling material. And what we do is we go into the pulp chamber and 2 millimeters into the canal and fill this whole area with the core. And then we do not, and I say it again, we do not need to place a post in most of the cases in a molar. Like we have done in this situation, you can see that a lot of the tooth structure is missing, but we have gone ahead without a post and we have done the core and the crown for it. But if posts are required, supposing we do need a post, then they need to be placed in the distal canal of the mandibular molar and the palatal canal of the maxillary molar. So this is very, very important. So mainly you have two types of posts. You have either a custom fabricated post or you have a prefabricated post. Custom fabricated posts are normally casted in the lab, or they recently have been made with zirconia. But even if custom fabricated posts are made, we do not recommend zirconia because number one, it does not bond to the tooth structure. It is very difficult to remove if a retreatment is required. We must always remember that we need to keep in mind that retreatments may be there, and therefore it is very essential that we are able to remove the post in case such a situation happens. So what about custom fabricated posts? They were the standard of care for a number of years. They have fallen out in favor now because you need multiple appointments for that, and also you need to temporize the tooth after root canal, which is not a great thing to do because you can contaminate the root canal system. And you also have additional laboratory fees to be paid. But in certain situations, they offer advantages because if the tooth is misaligned and the core and the post are at separate angles, then it is always better to do a custom post with metal. The ideal material to do a custom post is gold, but we all know that the cost of gold is enormous right now. And therefore, when we do custom posts, we do them with nickel chromium. The main advantage is that they're easier to retrieve if retreatment is required. And what are the disadvantages? Like I said, you require a temporary post and crown to be placed, and you can have contamination of the root canal system. And they are usually made of metal and not very aesthetic under all ceramic restorations. And of course, like all posts, they too can cause the root fracture. They can cause fracture of the root. So this is a situation where I went ahead and did a post and core. So in a situation like this, we should ideally go ahead and do crown lengthening, where we need to remove about 2 millimeters of the soft tissue and in some cases the bone around it. we take an impression and we fabricate a post like this in the lab. It is very critical to when, you know, when we are doing the positioning of the post, to be very careful, because if you try to force the post in, you can actually snap the root. You can create a crack in the root. So you need to put some rubber base on this and then take out the areas where it is binding to the root, and then fix the post. So this is after fixing the post, and you can see this ferrule around. You need 2 millimeters of tooth structure around your teeth, and that is known as a ferrule. And this is a PFM crown that has been given to the patient. This is another patient of mine. You can see here, you know, when you see it from the front, you feel that everything looks fine. But the problems with this are, number one, all of these are joined together. They are all individual teeth, but they're all joined together. And in my opinion, there is no reason why all of these teeth should be joined together. They should be individual crowns. And the problem is that maintenance is very, very important, very difficult when they are like this. We go ahead and we remove all the crowns out. The most difficult part is actually cutting the crowns out. And you can see here how much of the tooth structure has been destroyed. So we go ahead, along with my periodontist, we went ahead and did crown lengthening. You give that about a month to heal. Go back in, take an impression, make a prefabricated post like this. And then we went ahead and did 6 individual zirconia crowns for her. What about prefabricated posts? You have different materials, starting from stainless steel to fiber posts. And titanium out of them is the least used, because they are very brittle materials and they break. And therefore, as far as possible, we don't use them. So you can see here, this is nickel. These are the nickel chrome, nickel alloy posts. And these are the brass posts that were used earlier, but they are no longer used now because of the corrosion problem. And of course, ceramic and zirconia were used and are used sometimes. The problem with them is, number one, you need to have, because they are brittle, you need to have a lot of preparation done, and that can lead to fracture of the tooth. And secondly, they are very difficult to remove if a retreatment is required. Of course, fiber posts were introduced in 1990, and they are mainly the mainstay of posts now. So they were first made with carbon fiber, and now they are made with glass fiber. So these are glass fiber posts from 3M, they are excellent posts. And what are their advantages? Course, they're very aesthetic. The main thing is they form what is known as a monoblock, because the tooth bonds to the post and the post bonds to the filling material, and therefore it becomes like a monoblock. It minimizes wedging, and you need to remove less amount of tooth structure. Earlier, when I was a student, it was the larger the post the better, but now the thinner the post the better. So that is what we are doing right now. Then, of course, they can be removed easily, which I don't totally agree with, because you still need to burr them out completely, and they are not that's not the easiest of things to do. So yes, compared to ceramic and zirconia posts, they are easier to remove, but not that easy. What about post design? Basically, you have either tapered posts or parallel posts. And parallel posts are actually more retentive, but they require more dentin removal. So you can see here, these are the parallel posts and these are the tapered posts. So these will require much more removal of tooth structure. And you can have either active or passive posts. And this is an active post here, which are threaded into the tooth. And these are the passive posts, which are not threaded into the tooth. So active posts will engage dentin, and they transfer more stresses to the remaining tooth structure, and you get higher chance of tooth fracture in them. So if you see metal parallel sided post, it is more retentive. There is no wedging effect because there's no tapering. But it may not fit in this coronal area properly. It may weaken this area apically, and therefore, because there is more removal of tooth structure, you could get more fractures. And normally the failure is catastrophic. That means you will get fracture of the tooth, the root actually. What about tapered root, tapered post? They fit better. There is less chance of apical fracture. There is less chance of post fracture, but you can get root fracture due to the wedging effect, because this looks like a wedge. And the failure is often decementation and not catastrophic failure. What about modulus of elasticity? It is a mechanical property of a material to withstand the compression or elongation with respect to the length of the material. And if you see here, the modulus of elasticity of dentin is somewhere between 15 and 20. And that of the fiber post is somewhere in the region of 25 to 30. And as you go further, you find that zirconia and stainless steel are less, have a much higher modulus of elasticity. That means they are much more rigid, and therefore there is a higher chance of them causing a fracture. So this you can see how a metal post can lead to a root fracture here, and how a fiber post can reduce the amount of chance of a root fracture. Now, how do we place the post? We need to know the anatomy of the root. We need to remove a portion of the gutta percha. Okay, so you remove it either by thermal or mechanical means. Thermal means is with the help of a plugger, and you warm that and remove that. And mechanical means is with the help of either piezo reamers or gate slidden, or a combination of those and the drills that the company provides. So what should be the length of the post? You find that the length of the post should be equal to the clinical crown length, or it should be longer. Then it should be at least 2/3 the length of the remaining post. And the post should extend to at least 1/2 the length of the root, which is supported by bone. What about the width of the post? So you can see here how narrow this post is. That's all the width that we need. So post diameter makes little difference in the retention of the post. If there is an increase in post width, there is an increase in chance of root fracture. So that is very, very important. And it should not exceed more than 1/3 the width at its narrowest dimension. And a minimum of 1 millimeter of sound dentine should be maintained circumferentially. So you can see here, you can see this cast post here, and you can see a crack over here, and we actually had to go ahead and extract this tooth and go in and place an immediate implant for the patient. So it's very important that the as much as possible, the width of the post it should be reduced enough so that there is strength in the post, but it should not weaken the tooth. What about post cementation? So you have a number of materials, starting from zinc phosphate to resin cements. I think I don't need to go into the details of that. Normally, metal posts we used to cement with zinc phosphate. It's almost not used anymore at all. Its main advantage was that the post could be removed immediately because there was no bonding. Glass ionomer also we don't recommend using because it has lower modulus of elasticity, and therefore micro leakage is a major concern. So you can use resin modified glass ionomers, but glass ionomers alone are not recommended that they are used. What about resin cements? Their main advantage is when you use a fiber post, they are not as advantageous if you're using a metal post. So they will increase retention by bonding to the dentine. You have less micro leakage, and they provide at least short-term strengthening of the root. Like I said earlier, most posts do not provide strengthening of the root, but fiber posts for a short amount of term, they do provide some amount of strengthening. And there is higher fracture resistance of the teeth when posts are cemented with resin cement. The disadvantages are they are technique sensitive, and if there is any contamination either on the tooth or on the post surface, they will not bond. So it is extremely important to decontaminate the surface. And this is the material that I use. It's called Relax U200. And it's an excellent cement. There are different techniques for bonding. I will not go into the details of this. So you have either a total etch or a self-etch technique. Most of the current cements now are used the self-etch technique, where, for example, in the U200, you do not need to etch separately the tooth. You do not need to etch the tooth separately because the cement contains the etchant primer and the bond. And also you have, according to the number of steps, again, I'm not going to go into the details of that. You have 3-step, 2-step and single step. Most of the time we use the single step technique now, where the 8th generation bonding, where everything is present in a single bottle. So we don't need to, either we use a 2-step or a single step. So in the 2-step, we go ahead, we etch, dry, and then you apply the prime and bond, and then you put your cement inside and light cure. And in the single step, like in the single bond universal here, everything is contained within this one bottle here. So we don't need to do etching separately. Also, you need to take into account these materials which we use when we are doing endo. So sodium hypochlorite, EDTA, calcium hydroxide, endo sealers, of course, we don't use eugenol-based ones, and guttapercha. When you are bonding your post to the root, you have to make sure that there is no contamination from any of these materials, because if there is, you will not get proper bonding of the post and core, of the post to the root surface. How do you assess what kind of post to use? So you need to take a good radiograph. You need to carefully look at all this. You need to look at the length, the width, the angulation, and the curvature of the root, if there is any. So the post should be as long into the root as it remains above it. Therefore, this length should be at least 1:1. Here it is twice the length into the root and one into the crown. That's fine. But there must be at least 1:1 minimum. You can't have less than that in the root surface. Then it should be between 1/2 and 2/3 into the total root length, either 1/2 or 2/3 into the total root length, and remain in the straight part of the root. Because if you try to go into the curved part of the root, you can create a perforation here, or you can, along the line, you can have fracture of the root in this region. And it should conform to the size and shape of the root. Never try to put a larger size post into a tooth thinking that that's better. So that concept is no longer used. So you can see here you have one drill to remove the guttapercha, and then you have incremental drills depending on the size of the post that you use. So these are the different sizes. In my practice, 90% of the cases I use the yellow post, and 10% of the cases I use the red post, and I never use the blue post. I have never found the need to use a blue post. This we have already gone through. And you can see that the surface of the post has got this microporous structure. So this again helps us in getting some amount of retention to the cement. So what is the sequence of doing a post cementation? You remove all the debris in the canal. Then you clean with sodium hypochlorite. You rinse thoroughly with saline. You dry with paper moines, do not desiccate the canal. Then you coat the post with silane. You mix your U200 and use the spreader to load the material into the canal. You coat the post and place it into the canal. Rotate the post, hold firmly in place and light cure. So let's see a case. So this was a patient who came. Was a root canal tooth, which was where we had placed a crown. We had not placed a post in that. Like I said, nowadays, if I'm going to crown a tooth, then I will place a fiber post in that. So we took an X-ray. And again, here you can see I've removed the gutta percha. Cleaned the canal completely. Used alcohol and cleaned the post completely. Then I mix the cement, I load it into the canal, I load it onto the post, I light cure it. Light curing will cure some part of the post. The rest of it will cure with chemical cure. These are dual cure cements. And then I place the crown on it for it to record the correct contour. And this is after the posting core has been done. And what I do on the tooth is I go ahead and remove all the debris in the tooth structure that is there inside. I have an intraoral sandblaster. I will use the sandblaster and roughen the surface. I will use pumice, just plain pumice and water, a saline. And then I will mix and load the cement, place the cement over that, do a 2-minute tack cure to remove. So that it becomes easy to remove the debris, and then go ahead and allow the crown to harden properly. So I'll just show you a video now of this. It's not my video, but it will show you the process of how it happens. Are you able to see? Mohammed? So if you see here, you can see the U200 cement. You can see bulk fill material which you can use to make the core. And this is your 8th generation bonding material. Bonding. So we go ahead, we remove the after root canal. This is a temporary crown. We go ahead and here they're using sodium bicarbonate powder in a slurry to remove all the debris. You can just use your scaler. Go ahead with an aerator and remove all the gutta percha material. You can see there's a very huge access opening. These are the different drills that you have. So you use your drills. So this is the universal drill to remove the gutta percha from inside. Okay. Then here he has gone ahead with the red, that is the second size. Normally need to do very little drilling. You can see all the gutta percha is coming out, and he's doing all of this under rubber dam. He's cleaning the canal with sodium hypochlorite. And especially now that Corona is there, all of us will have to do all our procedures under rubber dam. Using root canals to, then the excess area of the post is cut with a disc. It is cleaned with alcohol. Dried nicely. And you can use your Relax U200. This is the US one, so it's called Unisem 2. In India, it's called U200. So you remove a little bit. Always remove the first bit, inject it into the canal. You can also hand mix it and do it. You don't have to do it like this. Then put the post inside. Light cure it. You can, this is the 8th generation, so we don't need the etchant. Light cure. You need a good quality light cure. The Chinese ones won't do. You fill bulk fill, you can use Filtek bulk fill. And that's how you do the pour. And then finally you will light cure it. So that's how we will go ahead and do a post and pour. Okay, this is another situation. Patient came to me, same thing. I had not done a post and he had fractured the tooth, but he had lost the crown. I'm sorry, no, he had the crown, but you can see the amount of tooth structure is much less than the previous case. So we went ahead, placed a post, did the core build up. Like so, this is an etchant and light curing. Done the preparation, always do gingival retraction. Two-step impression, so take a putty impression first. Remove all the interdental areas, inject light body onto the tooth surface and into the tray. And then take a nice impression with the... you must go beyond your margin. And this is ProTemp 4, which I use to make temporary crowns. So this is, I'm not sure whether this is the temporary. Anyway, once this is a Emax crown with this lithium disilicate. We etch it for 45 seconds. You can see a frosty surface. We put ceramic primer or silane into that. And then we go ahead and finally cement it, bond it in position. So here you can see that this is a 10-year-old PFM that I have done. And here we have actually done an all ceramic and we have been able to match the shade for that. This is another situation. You can see that the tooth is discolored. Ideally, I would not think of doing a crown for this, but if you see here, there is no lingual tooth structure at all. So same thing, endo, post, crown cutting, single step impression here, and the final crown in position. So core materials, you could have either amalgam or glassinum or composite. And the disadvantage of amalgam, we know you can't prepare immediately. Placement of amalgam is difficult and presence of mercury can be a problem. Again, glassinum we don't recommend. Composite, of course, we know the advantages and the disadvantages. And this is a very important concept that we should know. This is known as a ferrule. That means you need a 2 millimeter of tooth structure border around the complete tooth structure. If you do not have this, then whatever post and core or whatever you may do, you have a much higher chance of the tooth getting extracted. So either you need to do a surgical crown lengthening or orthodontic extraction of the tooth to achieve. Like here, you can see both these crowns. Definitely this crown, this tooth has a much better prognosis than this one, because here you have a 2 millimeter ferrule around. And here you can see there is no ferrule, and therefore the prognosis for this tooth is much, much lower than this. What about the final restoration? Like I said, if it is minimal loss of tooth structure, you can do composite. If you have aesthetic requirements, you can do bleaching or composite or a ceramic veneer. If you have moderate loss of tooth structure, you can do a post and composite restoration. And if you have severe loss of tooth structure, you can do a post, core and a crown. So you can do either a metal ceramic crown. The disadvantage of metal ceramics, you need to remove more amount of tooth structure. And you, or nowadays we do all ceramic crowns, either lithium disilicate or zirconia. And the advantage is that you have to do much less tooth reduction. You need to do only about a millimeter of tooth reduction. But if you're using it as an abutment for a bridge, then the maximum you can do with EMAX is only a 3-unit anterior bridge. So this is one of the cases that we did, like I showed you in the beginning. So patient had to undergo trauma, she fell, and we had to do root canal. We built up the tooth for her, like so. Put a post in, built up the core, went ahead. Did the crown cutting, did a single step impression, made immediate temporaries. I use only bisacral now for making temporaries. I no longer use monomer because of the, I no longer use cold cure acrylic. These are fantastic materials. They're a little more expensive than your acrylic, but they're much far better and far kinder to the tissue. And you can see here, you get very good shade matches. These are the final crowns that are come. We use light body to check the fit, or you can use fit check from GC. You polish it nicely. You use diamond polishing paste. You etch the crown. You can see the frosty appearance. You do priming. You clean the crown with pumice. Whether you are doing a PFM or an all ceramic, it doesn't matter what you are doing. You need to clean your crown with pumice. Then we go ahead and fix them with your resin cement. We do a 2-minute tack cure. Go ahead and remove all the excess, and this is the final crown in position. So you can see how beautifully you can get the aesthetics. And because of Corona, I couldn't ask her to come to the clinic, but you can see this is at least 8 years old, and these crowns are doing beautifully. What about this situation here? You can see the gums are all inflamed, and the reason for that is because you have no biologic width. So we have gone ahead and done osseous recontouring. Like here, we have got the biologic width back. We have made the temporary again. You can see how the tissues are now. And what is the biologic bit? Basically, the biologic bit is the space, is the space from the crest of the alveolar ridge to the gingival sulcus, the base of the gingival sulcus, and that should be 3 millimeters. If that is compromised, then the gingiva will flare up. We have gone ahead and done lava crowns. These are the gonia crowns for the patient. And you can see that you can get excellent aesthetics with a situation like this. What about posterior teeth? You can do either coronal coverage with onlay crowns, metal ceramic or all ceramic crowns, and you can do what are known as. Okay, I just have a couple more slides, so I'll just go through it. And so we go ahead and we do the same protocol. We etch it. We used to use U100 capsules, but we no longer use them. Cement the onlay over there and always use floss to remove the excess cement. What about crowns? You can have either metal ceramic or all ceramic. Metal ceramic, of course, have been used for a number of years. Main problem is that you have to do a lot extensive amount of tooth reduction. So now we are mainly doing all ceramic crowns where you have glass ceramics, the lithium disilicate EMAX crown, or you have the oxide ceramics, zirconia like lava, and there are many other companies. So this is a lithium disilicate crown. You can see we went ahead, this patient had got a root canal done and come in. When we checked the amalgam, we found that there was caries at the margin, so we removed that, went ahead, did a core build-up material for the patient and gave him a lithium disilicate. So this is the lithium disilicate in position, and you can see how aesthetic the crowns really are. And this is a monolithic zirconia crown, which we have done for a molar. The main advantage is you need to do less amount of reduction, except on the occlusal where you need about 1.5, and the rest of it you can do about a millimeter reduction, and you can see the crown in position. The main problem with this is it's opaque, and therefore it cannot be used in the anterior. And then of course you have something which has come out, which are known as the endocrowns now. And this is a study that has been done on endocrowns. And basically, what are endocrowns? They are actually crowns which do not, you do not put a post into the canal and you do not fill it up with a filling material. So, you are actually extending the crown into the root canal system. And they appear to be promising for molars. For premolars, the debonding rates are very high, so they are not recommended. And for incisors, of course, we do not do endocrowns at all. So mainly endocrowns are recommended for molars. And I personally don't have any experience with endocrowns. So you can see here that you need a good preparation and a good mastery of bonding technique. So all of these have to be done under rubber dam. And you need to use the nanocomposite resins and lithium disilicate to do this. So this is a good article that you can read about the fabrication of endocrowns, and it's a systematic review actually. So it's good. It's from the Journal of Prosthetic Dentistry. Just this year, I think it's 2020 Journal of Prosthetic Dentistry. And so if you see here, you find that, they found that there is 6 times higher chance of fracture of teeth of endodontically treated which were not, where crowns were not placed in the posterior region especially. So this is a very important study, which is the biomechanical consideration for restoration of endodontically treated teeth. And they have found that the most important criteria that you should have a rule that you should use adhesive procedures at both the radicular and coronal levels, and use portion code materials with physical properties close to that of natural dentine. So this is very, very important. So what should we do? During our practice, this is a very useful idea to use. So unless the majority of the natural tooth substance remains after endodontic treatment, it is safer to provide some kind of cuspal coverage in the final coronal restoration, since most teeth that require endodontic treatment usually are damaged severely as a result of caries, fracture, or both. So it is wherever we have a lot loss of significant amount of tooth structure, it is always better to do a coronal coverage, whether it is an inlay, onlay, or a endocrown or a crown. So we need to avoid bacterial contamination of the root canal system. We need to provide cuspal coverage for posterior teeth. We need to preserve radicular and coronal tooth structure. We need to use posts with adequate strength in thin diameters. We need to provide adequate post length for retention. We need to maximize the resistance form, including an adequate ferrule. That is very important. The ferrule will make all the difference. It doesn't matter what portion core material you use. If you do not have a ferrule, you do not have good prognosis. And use posts that are retrievable. So I would like to take this option to thank all of you for attending this webinar, and you know, also thank Mohammed especially for reaching out to me. And you know, I'm really happy that I came in and did this webinar, and I wish you all the very best. Thank you.
Thank you so much.